Something about that day and that gathering broke me. Filed onto the stage, young, vibrant, unapologetically African. Zanel Sithole, the Zanel musician. Anyone who really knows me knows him. Some of the places this music reaches into and draws a person out of him.
400 meters to go. Let's bring him home. This is history unfolding.
Shalom, beloved. How are you today? Yes, really, how are you today? Please let me know down in the comments. I wish you Hanan and Chesed from Elohim, our Father, the consummate power, and from our Master Yeshua HaMashiach, who is our strong, sustaining base. A quick note as we begin, this one's going to be good and long, and it's worth it. I've put the chapters in down below to make it easier for you to navigate, and I do hope that you will stick with me right through to the end. There's meat in this soup and there are chapels on the side. So mtashiba, stick with me, yeah? Stick with me. Today I'm sharing with you how I overcame depression and how to overcome depression. Let me set the scene for this video. As a writer and a storyteller, I found that writing down my thoughts gives me a better flow, so I'm going to proceed with the aid of my notes. The reason I'm documenting these stories, the reason I'm sharing them with you, is because I understand this principle. They overcame the adversary by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their witness, and they loved not their lives unto the death. These stories are sometimes hard to tell. It's not easy being this raw and this real, especially in this day and age we're living in. But I'm sharing these stories and I'm dying to myself because I'm coming from a point of healing and restoration. And I've been comforted by the stories of the men and the women in the scripture. And if you read those stories, you know just how very real and how very raw they are. And let's not forget that Yeshua himself said, "Fear them not. For there is nothing covered that shall not be revealed. There is nothing secret that shall not be made manifest, neither anything hidden that shall not be known. What you have spoken in the darkness shall be heard in the light. And what you spoke in the ear in the closet, baby, will be proclaimed on the rooftops." I also understand that the things we've gone through set example for others who may be going through those things right now. Your story can provide instruction, encouragement and hope to someone else, and it can help them endure and be patient on their own journey through it, especially when you bear witness of a truth and a living word that has been proven and refined in you. And that's what I'm going to be doing with this series of stories, clocking 40, the back story. So here we go.
Morning sun, I am a bird wearing a brown polyester shirt.
On the fourth day of the eighth month in the year 2010, at 1:45 p.m., my father passed away. The many years and the long months leading up to it had been dramatic and painful, Wrought with trauma. A few months earlier, we had buried his younger brother. A few months later, we buried his nephew. Both had been amongst my childhood favorites. The grief that assailed me that year was a new experience. It ravaged the depths of my being and it made me question my own existence. What's the point? Why are we even here? 2 years later, in the fifth month of 2012, my maternal grandfather also went to his rest. I didn't realize that his passing and that of my father would mark a totally new era in my life as I knew it. With the passing of these two pillars of my family, the houses that had been built in their names began to manifest the evidence of cracks and fissures below the surface that would result in the kind of dynamic shift I had never even imagined in my wildest dreams. Needless to say, human beings are resilient. We adapt to change. Life moves on and we just keep on going, leaving fragments of ourselves in the pits of the past. 9 years later, at about 10 a.m. on a Tuesday morning in April 2019, a young lady emerged from the Nyayo ward at the Moi Teaching and Referral Hospital in Eldoret, a major town in the Kenyan Rift Valley. She was a diligent, faithful, final year, straight A medical student, keen to graduate and become a doctor. She wanted to be a blessing to others, a blessing to her family. But in that particular moment, this young lady and a couple of her colleagues were headed to class after having completed their daily ward rounds. They talked as they walked, little knowing that an obsessive man armed with an axe and a panga was creeping up behind them.
Police have arrested a 28-year-old suspect accused of murdering a sixth-year medicine student at the Moi University in Eldoret.
That afternoon, I received the shocking news that my cousin had been murdered in broad daylight. Slain in a vicious act so grievous, it prompted an immediate, impassioned response of mob justice in a course of events that made the national headline. Beautiful, brilliant, and greatly beloved, she was the firstborn child of another one of my childhood favorites, a bright light in the family, a child of so much promise, slain on the eve of her 25th birthday. Just over a week later, on the 18th of April 2019, our whole family and thousands from the extended community gathered to bid her farewell. Her funeral was televised nationwide. Something about that day and that gathering broke me. It wasn't just the despair we felt and the tragedy of such a premature, senseless loss of vital life. For me, there was also the abiding feeling of such a deep, prevailing, internal isolation in the midst of a gathering so large, and the complete breakdown of so many familial relationships that had been such a core of my youth. There was also the accumulated residue of past trauma and dysfunction. Added to that was the fact that I was then at a tipping point in my life, coming to terms with the demise of yet another dream, a passion project that I had begun with such great heart and so much promise. I tried so hard to make it work, but it didn't, fading away in shame and ignominy. It was yet another failure in a series of many, a trend in my adulthood that I couldn't quite comprehend, especially when I thought back to the vast potential I had demonstrated in the achievements of my childhood. Hebu guys, yani, just give me a moment ni reminisce.
it before it turns truth into lies. Oh, but I won't back down. I must stay on this road. I gotta know what I'm about.
Yes, I was that girl on Prize Giving Day. Now fast forward to 2019. I wasn't fully aware of how deeply fragmented my soul was at that point, until one day in the fifth month, soon after my cousin's funeral, I came home to my tiny little space, worn to the bone, longing so deeply to make a difference, knowing so intimately the lack of independence, seeing so clearly the specter of my own irrelevance. I shut the door behind me and I lay down on the floor. And I was there, like that, in that dark space, that dark place, prone for a week, not eating, not thinking, not drinking, not doing much of anything. I was unable to master the energy. The only thing I really wanted was to simply disappear. For 7 months thereafter, a deep, numbing depression set upon me, sinking my spirit into a dark miasma of such futility, it drained my soul and it left me hollow inside. There were many, many days when I looked and felt and smelled like a mindless beast. And I really didn't care. Because so much of me just wasn't there. And there were many, many dark moments of startling rationality when I would return to myself and seriously consider just how to end it all, while looking back to the times in the past when I had tried it. Because I had tried it. The first time, I was 13. In my final year of primary school, caught between a rock and a hard place. Desperate for a way out of a very traumatic season, I swallowed as many expired pills or paracetamol as I could find. For some reason, they didn't take effect at all. I don't quite remember what I told my deskmate, but out of concern, she informed her mother, who was then our class teacher. That first attempt ended with a hastily summoned family conference in the headmaster's office. I recognize it was really a desperate cry for help on my part, but the embarrassing outcome only added to my fear and anxiety. The second time, I was 18, fresh out of high school, navigating tremendous conflict in an attempt to forge an artistic pathway in life. I had long formed the habit of shutting myself up in the closet, literally in the wardrobe, to play my dad's stereo and to perform in the dark to the one in heaven and the crowds in my heart. But in that moment, I just longed to get away. That second attempt ended with some lyrics and a verse and a cross etched into my arm. Here's the a cappella version. Sitting in my closet, a razor in my pocket, to end the life that caused so many sad moments. Going through the process and trying to find the sources of the pain I gave in those evil doses. I feel I gotta do this, so I'm just gonna lose it. And I don't wanna live this bitter life a loony. And even if I die, ain't no one gonna cry. And I really do not need to tell you why. I've been looking out my window, searching for tomorrow. In the sky above, hoping that I'll find some love. Think of yesterday and I don't know just what to say. Dreams are left behind, dead and dying deep inside, man. 10 minutes gone by, trying to make up my mind. 10 minutes this night, I wanna end my life. You say that I'm a fool, well try and put on my shoes. Coming into my gloom, can you handle this doom? Tell me, was I born to die and find a home in hell? Is that the story of this girl that time is going to tell? Every day this voice is speaking in my head. They're telling me the girl, you know you'd rather just be dead. Cause how can anyone who's been as bad as me, a different person ever be? These tragic epitomes ringing in my head. Daily episodes that would end if I was dead. My heavy heart is in prison, my lonely soul is locked up. And this empty frustration be just a song of the damned.
Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, I be here on this day crying out to thee. For I heard of Jesus, that he came to free us. I just don't know if he can dwell inside of Judas. I know that I'm a prisoner, I've always been a dreamer. I only wish that I could be a true believer. Oh, I've read the Bible and I've seen revivals. I know that Jesus is the key to my survival, but can he really hear me? Cleanse me clean deep within. Can he really hear me? Set me free from my sin. Cause it's more than razzmatazz, all of this showbiz jazz. It's all about your heart and where you've put your trust. Is it in Christ or man? For his delight he has made you. Why don't you let him fill you too?
Clearly, I was deeply depressed. Ironically, I won a singing competition with a version of this song the year after I cleared high school. That memory, lives deep inside of me. The thrill I felt in that moment was very deep, intense, and fleeting. And it was here, and then it was gone. I'm not sure if I'd heard of the competition prior, but my performance was certainly not planned. I just used to hang out in church seeking an outlet and a refuge and performed on an impulse. But that was also my kawaida. I've always had this irresistible urge, an almost tangible compulsion to get up on stage to speak or perform. And for those guys who might know, I was competing with Akina DNG in that compay, guys. The prize was an opportunity to record a demo with Innovator, you know, the producer Tim Rimbui. But for one reason or another, that didn't quite pan out. You know, lifing. But at that time, I had not yet realized how deeply depressed I really was, even with those kind of lyrics. Looking back now, I can recognize when that spirit began to set in. And I think it was when I was 11, already a secret heathen. And life had begun to become a very heavy burden. Depression first showed up as a feeling, and then it became a way of thinking until eventually the spirit of depression found its way into me. It adversely affected my behavior, my performance, my outlook, my convictions, my environment, and my relationships. It was something that I couldn't hide, yet it wasn't being clearly identified for what it really was. I mean, depression. What's depression? I also didn't recognize the progression of my condition from then on through high school. I just thought I was this strange, inconsistent, and highly undesirable person. Just someone disobedient, as others put it. Now here I was again, seriously considering a third attempt. Only two things restrained me. The first was a distinct abiding thought that wouldn't leave me alone. Sijamaliza, I have not yet finished. In the midst of my despair and in the clasp of these suicidal impulses, something inside of me really wanted to know, what is the point? Why am I even here? The second thing restraining me was this. I couldn't figure out a way to exit without hurting someone. There was just no clean exit. Now, it took some time, but the first major shift in the state of my psyche was inspired by a video that popped up on my YouTube feed. It featured a youth choir from South Africa that was auditioning for the 2019 cycle of AGT, America's Got Talent. I watched as the group filed onto the stage. Young, vibrant, unapologetically African. Hailing from Mutse, a small community in rural Limpopo, the Ndlovu Youth Choir had been formed in 2009, emerging from a care group program seeking to address the needs of orphans and vulnerable children in that community. I'm telling you guys, man, That performance was a straight shot of joy to my soul. It's like someone took a hypodermic needle and just plunged it straight into my soul. I'm telling you, it sent these shivers down my back that was so delightful, I began to cry. It was so refreshing to feel again, to experience bliss, you know, to be alive. They reminded me of my African dream, of my place in the circle of life, and of my role as a cultural custodian. Through that entire cycle of EGT, I would wait week after week, thrilled to watch their infectious high-energy performances as they steadily progressed right through to the grand finale. They gave me something to anticipate in a season that was seriously touch and go for me. I would forget myself completely as I rooted for them, infused with the spirit of their love, their joy, their energy, you know, their heartfelt enthusiasm. I'm telling you, their rhythms and harmonies are a feast for the ears. Their story deeply inspiring, their music a balm to the soul. You see, for me, music has always been a deep passion and lifeline, a mode of transport, a place of refuge, and a way to express my soul. And YouTube being what YouTube is, eventually it brought onto my feed the work of another South African musician, Sanel Sithole, the Sanel musician. Anyone who really knows me knows him because his music is so deep in my marrow, even my unborn descendants know his name. I'm praying for you, brother, lifting you up because, man, you guy. Some of the places this music reaches into and draws a person out of, hey, watch out too. So Sanel, I'm really, really looking forward to the day I can tell you this in person and I'm upholding you in prayer. So now, that was the first shift in my psyche. Mind you, I had completely isolated myself within that space. I wasn't interacting with people. My family would come by, you know, trying to knock on the door to check in on me. Wapi, woi. Sometimes it's like I was in another world. I can hear them, but I'm not there. And I don't have any energy to respond or any desire to do so anyway. You know, you're just hoping for that quieter space, that silence you think is out there in the dark. That's the one I was looking for. And the room was dark. I had blacked out everything. I was rarely even going out. And I would look for to go out in those times when I knew I wouldn't encounter anyone. Bliss for me was to be in a deep sleep, not thinking, not feeling. So it is during this season that these shifts are happening within that space. The second shift in my psyche was prompted by a fellow Kenyan, a humble farmer and a family man just a year younger than me, hailing from Eldoret, where my cousin had been murdered. On the 12th of October, 2019, at 8:15 a.m. Central European Summer Time, on the Reichsbrück, I killed that bridge in Vienna, Austria, Eliud Kipchoge set out to break a human barrier, determined and destined to make history. Holding both the first and the second fastest marathon times at that time, Kipchoge had amured that he was going to break the two-hour barrier for running that distance, 42.195 kilometers. And the weather was just right for it, around 9 degrees Celsius with a bit of a kafog here. The wind was circulating at a speed of between 0.5 to 1.5 meters per second. You know, good conditions. Mind you, this thing that he was setting out to do was a benchmark previously considered impossible to breach. Yani, it was a feat that many scientists had claimed would not be achieved for another, like, 50 years. 50 years. But Eliud ni nani? He knows himself. He remained undeterred. This would be his second attempt at the sub-2 in a form of road racing that he had steadily raised into new stratospheres by his remarkable performances over the years. At that time, he had become the greatest ever marathoner, widely recognized by many as one of the greatest sportsmen in history. And Kipchoge had a message to pass. He wasn't just running. He has always had a reason to run. Just like another guy from Hapo Zamani Zakale, alikuwa anaitwa Pheidippides or Pheidippides or Pheidippides, depending on who you are and where you come from. The first man to run a marathon. Aya, let me break this down for you. Wacha nikupe story. You see, legend has it, by way of another ancient guy called Lucian, that sometime in August or September of 490 before Common Era, BCE, this Pheidippides guy, or Pheidippides, served as a messenger in Athens, a herald, mtumishi wa watu. Now, during that time, the Persian army had invaded ancient Greece with a huge army under King Darius I. He had set out to subjugate the many divided Greek states and to add them to his already vast territories. So in 490 BCE, in that first invasion of Greece, Darius landed his huge army and his extensive fleet on a beach near the Athenian town of Marathon. The Athenians, with a much smaller but very strategic army, marched out to face these invading Persians, and imagine, they won the battle, causing the Persians to flee, leaving over 6,000 casualties on that battlefield. Now, there are different versions of this story, but according to Lucian, the Athenian Greeks were concerned that the fleeing Persians might send out false breaking news, yani news of a false victory on their part. So they sent Pheidippides, the herald, to run and inform the Spartans, another Greek state, of the Greek victory as soon as possible. In other versions of this story, it is reported that he was actually sent out to seek help from the Spartans, who had declined to come to the aid of the Athenians by claiming the observation of some religious festival. That was their usual excuse. Wacha vile tunaambiwa Sparta. Yes, there's that part, but there's also this one. So now, Pheidippides sets off, yani kutoka the battlefield in Marathon hadi the Greek capital in Athens, which was about 42 kilometers away. Ametimua mbio, running non-stop, akichomoa nguo na weapons ili akuyamlite afike huko faster. Can you imagine running alone for hours and hours, mile after mile, shedding your clothes and weapons along the way in an attempt to get there faster? When Pheidippides finally reached his destination, bursting into the Greek assembly naked, he gasped, "Hooray! Victory! We've won!" and dropped down dead, pop, breathing his last. Mm-hmm. So now, when the modern Olympics started in the summer of 1896, the initiators and organizers were looking for a great popularizing event. They rallied around the idea of a marathon race modeled after the legend of this guy, the late great Pheidippides. And then, inspired by the great success of that first Olympic event, the Boston Marathon made its debut in the spring of the next year, 1870, and became a precursor to many of the long-standing marathon events we have today, held in different cities the world over on a nearly weekly basis. Even us guys in boarding school, we had to run cross-country marathon, imagine. Yani, you guy. So now it is in this general trend of human endeavor that the Ineos 159 challenge came into being. This event was specifically created for Eliud Kipchoge, orchestrated and executed under very, very controlled conditions. The circuit featured four laps of the Hoptali, a historic tree-lined avenue in the Prata, characterized by its long straight sections and protection from the wind. For this reason, it proved ideal as the location for the Ineos 159 challenge. Now, huyu Kipchoge, kumbukeni, he had already made an attempt at a sub 2 at the Monza racetrack in Italy, participating in the Nike Breaking 2 event on the 6th of May 2017, just 2 years prior. That effort ended with Kipchoge coming so close, so close. Yani alipita the 2 hour mark by just 25 seconds. That's like a lifetime in marathons and racing, but hey. But this time round, things were going to be different. Let me tell you why. And pay close attention, because life isn't a sprint, it's a marathon. And these 6 pointers are crucial if you want to finish it strong. So number one, waiting for him at the finish line was his family, his wife Grace, and their 3 children. Yani Eliud ako hapo poised at the start, calm, relaxed, focused. Grace naye anaomba, amefunga macho, head bowed. Mikono ameshika hivi in a silent prayer. When he finished the race, she was waiting for him with open arms. So ask yourself this. Do you have a family? If not, make one. Love and be loved. Number two. Hapo pia kingoja kwa finish line na familia yake was his coach, his mentor, and his friend Patrick Sang. This is a man who had become a surrogate father over the years. His coach from the very beginning of his career, from day one. Na walikuwa wakienda tu pamoja run after run, race after race, year after year. He was also standing there at the finish line. So ask yourself this. Do you have a mentor? If not, get one. Yoke yourself to a credible authority and be willing to learn. Number three. This time round with this race, unlike ile time ya Nike breaking two, kulikuwa na crowd lining the entire course. There was a crowd from the beginning to the end, kutoka mwanzo hadi mwisho. Vienna came out to witness history. 120,000 supportive screaming fans sharing their love, their energy, their support. And these are my vibes, man. That living presence. You know, performers like us know that energy. You guys, it's a very real thing. Inspiring someone is literally getting them to breathe life into you. So ask yourself this. Are you an inspiration? If not, be one. Write down your vision and make it plain. As you breathe into it, there are those who will breathe into you. Okay? You with me? Number four. Eliud didn't just get up that day and decide, you know, to watch today, guys. I'm breaking sub two. No. This event was the culmination of a long, steady career and a grueling 4 to 5 months of train, eat, rest, repeat. Train, eat, rest, repeat. Train, eat, rest, repeat. Train, eat, rest, repeat. Again, train, eat, rest, repeat. So, ask yourself this. Do you have a discipline? If not, develop one. Moment by moment, day by day. Line upon line, precept upon precept. And number five, the whole team, baby. The whole team. We all witnessed the beautiful unified rhythm of Eliud's team of 41 pace setters. Running in a formation preceded by an electric timing car. Each of these men accomplished in his own right, some of them the best middle and long distance runners on the planet, united by a brother with a vision and a quest. And we all witnessed the care and precision of the entire technical team that joined together to make this event happen, both on and off screen. Nakwambia ilikuwa broadcast live, reaching an estimated 500 million homes in 196 countries worldwide. Talk about greatness, man. Live to 500 million homes in 196 countries worldwide. So ask yourself this. Do you have a team? If not, pray for one. Yahweh knows the hearts of men and He will send you the right ones. Finally, number six, as we do in Kenya, budgets. Money, 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 money. You know, when you've proven your worth time and time again, pesa haiwezi kosekana, na pesa huza pesa. And resources will always be available to a person who is faithful. And those resources bear fruit. Plus, he who is faithful with little is faithful with much. Just go back into Eliud Kipchoge's history and just see. He'd proven himself. Mtanielewa. So ask yourself this. Do you have resources? If you think not, wake up. Be faithful with what you have in your hand, and what you have will grow itself up and draw more resources to you. Let's rewind, selector. Turudi kwangu, October 2019. I was one of those watching. Kwa simu tu, sitting alone in the dark in my little home. Safaricom nao walikuwa wame to organize because this was a big deal in Kenya. You guy. Sasa mimi niko hapo. Nalia tu. I'm just crying. When I remember Kipchoge running that final stretch, you guys. Hakisi nililia.
He's almost there. He can see the finish line. That's the view from Eliud Kipchoge. You can see the finish line where we are looming into view. 157 and approaching 158. I think we can say with some certainty
there
now
he
he's going to do it. He's
going to
do it.
He's going. He's telling him to move away.
Come on, he says. Come on, this is it. Shalina, final thought from
incredible.
You.
This is incredible. Eliud's performance is such a gift to the world. His running is a gift to all of us. I feel so blessed to be here today. I feel like, I hope everyone can hear me smiling through this microphone right now. I cannot stop smiling.
500 meters to go. He has the Haupt Allee to himself. All the pacemakers have let him go. As Ed said, he is sprinting into the history books here. They're cheering him on. 400 meters to go. Let's bring him home. This is history unfolding on the streets of Vienna this morning. It's a Saturday run like we've never seen before. Listen at the noise, the crowd getting right behind him. Goodness me, 300 meters to go. He can see the finish line here. Neil Armstrong we had on the moon in 1969. We had Roger Bannister, the 4-minute mile 65 years ago. Edmund Hillary, the first man to climb Everest in 1953. We have 1 minute to go. Eliud Kipchoge is on his way here.
This humble,
farmer who used to run 2 miles to school every day and back. He used to go to the nearest town on his bike to sell milk at the local market. And now, through hard work and discipline, he's pointing. Come on, he says. Eliud Kipchoge has the hand of history on his shoulder. He has less than 200 meters to go. Eliud Kipchoge, let's keep an eye on the clock. Into the final 20 seconds. Eliud Kipchoge.
Whoa!
On his shoulder. 140. 140. The unofficial
line. There's his wife.
Eliud Kipchoge storms into the history books in Vienna. 159.40, the unofficial time. The first man to run a marathon in under 2 hours. One final lung-busting stride for Kipchoge. One giant leap for human endeavor. And you know, Kipchoge was right. No human is limited.
I watched him through my tears, uplifted by the raising noise of the cheering, thundering crowd. His face glowing, a band of athletic brothers running behind him. That last team of the 41 elite champion athletes, hailing from Kenya, Uganda, Ethiopia, Stato, Norway, Australia, Switzerland, Turkey, and Japan. Haki niliona hao wase wana celebrate, cheering him on as he raced forward and emerged from the pack. Every one of them accomplished in their own right. Every one of them having served as his pacemakers, a literal shield to ensure that he fulfills his dream, you guys. Hey, wacha tu abuke finish line hivi, a big smile on his face, running with outstretched arms straight to his wife and his children. Kila mtu amefurahi ni kurukaruka tu, you guys. Kurukaruka tu, eh? And the official time, 1 hour, 59 minutes, 40.2 seconds. He had run the distance of 42.195 kilometers non-stop at an average speed of 21.2 kilometers per hour. He splitting every single kilometer between 2 minutes 48 seconds and 2 minutes 52 seconds every kilometer, becoming the first human in history to run a sub-2-hour marathon. And still, at that finish line, bado akona energy, he's giving interviews, eh? And what is his message?
You've done it.
Yes.
How are you feeling?
I am feeling good. It has taken 65 years for a human being to make history in sport. After Roger Bannister made history in 1954, it took another 63 years. I tried and I did not get. Now it's 65 years. I have tried. I'm the happiest man to run under 2 hours in order to inspire many people, to tell people that no human is limited. You can do it. I'm expecting more of the athletes in peace all over the world to run under 2 hours after today. The first thing is today, when I woke up at 5, at 4:50, to actually the starting time, that's 8:15, it was my hardest times even before the start. The time, actually it was 4 hours, but it was like 30 minutes. So it was the hardest times. But all in all, the race is actually, the first kilometer is really hard the way it is. It needs actually the perseverance, it needs dedication, it needs the hard run, yes.
Your pacemakers were fantastic, start to finish as well.
Absolutely. Remember, the 41 pacemakers are among the best athletes ever in the whole world. From the Matthew Sandro, it's the one of the world Olympic champion for 1500, to all the marathoners and everyone, they are the best. I can say, I want to say thank you for them. I want to appreciate them for accepting to do the job. And together, it is not, I am not telling you, we made this do together in this one.
It's a genuine joy talking to you. It'd be remiss of me not to mention your wife and your three wonderful children as well, though.
Actually, my wife and my two children are giving me more support. I'm happy for them to come and witness the history. They will be among those who made the history. I am happy for them.
And just finally, Elliot, what image would you like us to take away from this? You genuinely made me cry watching you cross the finish line. What would you like us to remember about this?
Actually, I want to say the positivity of sport. Actually, I want to make the sport a clean sport. I want to make sport an interesting sport whereby all the human beings can run, can wake up very early in the morning, to run. And together, when we run this world, we can make this world a beautiful world. You can kick away most of the diseases by just running. It will be a beautiful one.
It's a privilege talking to you. It was a privilege watching you run. And on behalf of every athletics fan around the world,
yes,
thank you very much.
Thank you too. Thank you very much. Thank you to the whole world. Thank you to those who watched me through Facebook, those who watched me through YouTube, those who watched me live. And I can say, actually, I am appreciating your time that you sit behind your TVs, behind your mobile phones, behind everything, even following through Twitter and everything, that you have made history together, and together you can make this world a beautiful world. Thank you very much.
Oh, that moved me, you guys. That moment. Like every time I watch those clips, every time I watch that entire race, because I do from time to time, it takes me back to those moments, to that season in my life, and to what that felt like. And as I watched Kipchoge, I asked myself, what will it take for me to keep the faith and finish my race? Can I endure nimalize tu? Can I endure and finish strong? I know the race is not to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, nor bread to the wise, nor riches to men of understanding, nor favor to men of skill, but time and chance happen to them all. What then is the point? Why am I even here? Why am I even here? A couple of months later, COVID-19 ndio hiyo, breaking out in the Chinese city of Wuhan and beginning to sweep the globe. Yani 2020-2021, tuko hapo tu. Virus ikizunguka dunia mzima inafagia watu tu ikipita. He, halafu ina mutating into lethal strains that defy the desperate containment measures put in place by governments and individuals. Unajua tushasahau. Tushasahau vile tulikuwa lockdown dunia mzima, watu tu wakienda. Tushasahau. Like human beings. As one lockdown after another was enforced in city after city, country after country, we all found ourselves isolated, restricted to our homes, forced to adapt and adjust everyday activities and interactions so often taken for granted. Nakwambia hii pandemic, the things it triggered, social and economic disruption worldwide, precipitating the largest global depression since the Great Depression of the 1930s. Ladies and gentlemen. Huh? Na tuko hapa 2024, sindio? Bado recovery. I'm going to balance out that statement though by saying this. That's one side of the coin. If you're out there in the world, that's the reality that was being experienced. If you're disconnected from the source and the creator, that was what was being made manifest and coming to the fore. But there was another side to what was happening. Because human beings were constrained and restrained in their homes, and a lot of the activities we had been engaging in for decades and centuries past had been brought to a complete or an almost complete standstill. Creation was throwing a bash, it was thriving. Creation had a resurgence of vital life restored to it. Wildlife in the game reserves and the national parks, the quality of the air, the earth, yani, despite the fact that there was a sinister plan in this demic, the Most High is sovereign. And he granted creation a jubilee that was so desperately needed. As I observed and personally experienced all that was happening, foremost on my mind were the questions. Is life really worth living? What's the point? Why are we even here? Let me also just give you some insight into what was happening on my end. In that December of 2019, when COVID-19 was breaking out in Wuhan, I had just received notice to vacate from the space I was renting. I had no idea where I was going to go because the notice was unexpected and my income was non-existent at that time. Plus, ni end year. I'd barely managed to secure that space in the first place, and I was attached to it because it had been part of a creative project that I'd really poured my heart into. You know, the creative project I was talking about earlier. Yeah. By Yahweh's grace, when lockdowns and all that were happening in 2020, family friend received me into her home and she hosted me for 5 months. For 5 months. I'm so grateful for that family and for the grace they extended to me. During that time, I also had the opportunity to assist on their farm, working with the chicken, planting beans, weeding, harvesting maize, and all that jazz. It wasn't an easy season for me to navigate. You know, I was trying to figure my life out. And then there's that anxiety one has when your primary base is not secure and you don't know quite how to secure it. Plus, there's also the element of, as a believer, walking by faith and trusting in the Most High to direct my steps and superintend my way. It was also a season of pruning and chastening for me. I was in that season also because of so many stupid mistakes I had made in my past. Stupid mistakes, I'm telling you, man. You guy, I was reaping what I had sown, baby. And when you farm, you learn. You reap what you sow. You do. So as I observed and I personally experienced all that was happening, foremost on my mind were the questions. Is life really worth living? What's the point? Why are we even here? It seems to me that all my life I have been asking these two questions, actively seeking the answers to them. What's the point? Why are we even here? What's the point? Why am I even here? I need to know so I can live. Early on in my existence, I recognized the evidence of intelligent design all around me. The very fact of my DNA assured me that whoever or whatever designed my genetic code and brought me into being must have also had a living record, an existential code somewhere that I could follow. I mean, just consider your DNA for a moment. Isn't it amazing that from the very moment you are conceived, from the very moment a child is conceived, the code required for you to manifest into the physical being that you are is already in you? Isn't that fascinating? I mean, just think about it for a moment. Added to that is the fact that the one who brought us into being has encoded his very name into our DNA. The creator literally signed off on his masterpiece. So I figured that if I could just find his instructions, then I would also find in them the answers to the questions I kept asking. What's the point? Why are we even here? And we all know the manufacturers always have a manual. Well, there is a principle in the scripture that states, ask and you shall receive, seek and you shall find, knock and the door shall be opened unto you. I cried out to the Creator and he led me to himself. He who is the way, the truth, and the life revealed himself to me by his word and by his spirit. And as I put my faith in him and believed upon his name, I began to experience his tangible presence in my life. I'm here to bear my witness in the hope that you too will encounter and get to know him. I'm also writing a manuscript, which is the result of my ongoing quest, an effort to decipher the essence of my existence, a collaboration between the Creator and myself. It is the fruit of 16 years of conscious, diligent study, the outcome of 10 complete readings through the scripture, cover to cover, plus kuchambua huko kwa history doing research. And let me tell you guys, in those pages of the scripture, I have encountered people just like you and me, experiencing the same anxiety, uncertainty, and fears that we have faced. In their stories, I have perceived the struggles and challenges I encounter as a human being. I recognize myself in their disappointments and in their failings. When they triumph, I rejoice, exhilarated by their victories, resonating with the expression of their hopes and their dreams. In other words, I found me. I saw me. I heard me. I felt me. In there was me, myself, and I. The good, the bad, the ugly, the past, the present, the yet to be, all of it was in there. And I am seeing him, Yahweh Yeshua. He who is, he who was, he who is to come. The bearer of breath who brings all into being. The source and the force. The Aleph and the Tau. The first and the last. The antecedent of time. The ancient of days. Existence himself. The one who simply is. I see him and I hear him and I feel him in the word and in the breath, in the spirit and in the flesh. I am seeing him, and in seeing him, I recognize myself. He who the sun sets free is free indeed. So I keep asking, I keep seeking, I keep knocking. And I am becoming just like him, moment by moment, day by day, line upon line, precept upon precept, a little here and a little there. Someday soon enough, I too will be all that he has designed me to be. And though I'm not yet perfect, that's okay. I will be. I'm getting there. I know now that no one can break me. I'm already broken. And that's all right. I'm broken and contrite. Sitakubali mtu anifeze. I'm flowing through time, baby. Through every phase, I'm becoming defined. This manuscript started off as just a simple collection of handwritten notes from and for my own personal study. But over the years, it has filled me up and steadily grown beyond me. I have often found myself duplicating, you know, those handwritten notes for my family and friends, teaching impromptu classes, rising out of random comments in random moments in random spaces. Now here it is, as it were, adulting, a full course meal for the human being. A delicious dish tempered by reality and cooked in its vagaries. Salted with humor and seasoned with spice, it has steeped in conviction and been tested by time. Taste the flavors of favor, feel the doses of danger, delight in the ride, baby. This here is a special spread for you. Serve along with a poetic side, victuals basted in the sauces of life, peppered with sorrow and hopes for tomorrow. Marinate, take your time. soak in the wisdom, sit with reason for a while, light a fire, feel desire, sit your belly on the daily. For in the years I have labored to bring this forth, it has fried in my frustrations and simmered through my shame. And when I boiled in the throes of bother, it withstood the angst of my blame. This here is a full course meal for the human being, a delicious dish, tempered by reality and cooked in its vagaries. Karibuni. Bon appetit. It is also an operator's manual and a travel guide, a dictionary, a sojourner's journal, a time travel device. It is a history book and a basic roadmap, a player's aid to this present age, a record of insight into time and space. It is a transitory tool for that which is to come, a reference and a resource, a prophecy and a promise, delving deeper, seeking greater, reaching higher. Yani, this is a record I have sincerely prepared, carefully transcribed and faithfully presented to you. And I am as you are, a seeker, a spiritual being on an earthly sojourn, a member of humanity created in the image and likeness of the bearer of being himself. I am just a guide, not a guru. I am a novice in the art of living and being lived in. It is my delight to be a witness to you, like a prototype, you know? Liberated in knowing that Yahweh's name sets itself apart. His word defines, his breath manifests, his being refines. And where there are any errors of commission or omission on my part, MCC, I sincerely apologize and I trust the Spirit of the Most High himself to make known his instructions to you in the name of Yeshua. It's my aim in this record to convey to you the thoughts of the Creator as he spoke them and as he intended them to be received. Because in the ancient blueprint that he gave to mankind is a template for humanity. There's an existential code in there for the existential identity crisis we all face at some point in our lives. The answer to the questions, who are we? What are we? Why did we come into being? Who am I? What am I? Why did I come into being? So on that note, I would like in the next section of this video to share some principles and concrete steps that will equip and empower you to overcome depression. And these are battle strategies that are proven and founded on the scripture, a double-edged sword with which to slay your enemy. I'm also going to attach a PDF version of that section of the video in the description box below, so you'll be able to download it for yourself and study it at your own time. So guys, man, let me have a sip of water, take a breather, and then we'll come right back in. And this next section is gonna be very interactive, so come prepared to engage. And before I, you know, go off on that little break of mine, I'd also just like to request you to subscribe to the channel. If this content is of value to you, you know, put a thumbs up, like the video, share the content, share a comment, engage with me and with this community. Let's build a family together. See you on the other side. Welcome back, people. In this masterclass on overcoming depression, I'm going to equip you with the knowledge, the truth, the armor, and the tools you need to do so. And I'm also going to demonstrate to you how to apply these resources in overcoming depression. We are going to do it together right here and right now. And we're not alone in this process. Emmanuel is with us, for he promised, "Verily I say unto you, whatsoever ye shall bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever ye shall loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Again I say unto you that if two of you shall agree on earth as touching anything that they shall ask, it shall be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, there am I in the midst of them." Avinu, our Father who is in heaven, seated upon the throne, observing us here in this moment upon the earth, which is your footstool. We call upon your name and we bless you. We enter into your gates with thanksgiving and into your courts with praise, ushered in by your Spirit with whom you have sealed us and by whom we call you Abba, Father. And we come before your throne of Hanan and Chesed with boldness and confidence. We come before your throne of divine enabling and the devotion to meet our needs in the name of the Anointed One, Yeshua HaMashiach, the firstborn over all creation, who by his blood has opened a new and living way into your dwelling place, into the inner courts, the most set apart place. Blessing and honor and weight and power be unto you, Father, who sits upon the throne, and unto the Lamb forever and ever. For he was slain and has redeemed us by his blood unto you, Elohim, the consummate power, out of every tribe and tongue and people and nation, and has made us kings and priests unto you, our power. We are heirs of you, Elohim, and co-heirs with the Anointed One, Yeshua, who has preceded us before you as our high priest and our advocate. With him we shall reign upon the earth. Blessed are you, Elohim, who at various times and in diverse manners spoke in times past to our fathers by the prophets. You have, in these last days, spoken unto us by your Son, whom you have appointed heir of all things, by whom also you made the worlds, who being the brightness of your weight and honor, and the express image of your person, upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged sins, sat down on the right hand of the majesty on high, disarming all principalities and powers and making a spectacle of them openly, having triumphed over them. Yahweh, we bless you and we thank you for Yeshua laying down his life for us and having made shalom, peace through the blood of his cross, for reconciling all things unto yourself. And we who were dead in missing the mark and in the uncircumcision of our flesh, you have now quickened together with him, having forgiven us of all trespasses. You have blotted out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and have taken it out of the way, nailing it to the cross. Blessed are you who raised Yeshua from the dead, you who have seated us with him at your own right in the heavenlies, far above all principality and power and might and dominion, over every ruler and authority and every name that is named, in this age and in that which is to come. And you have put all under his feet and given him head over all the called out ones, which is his body and his bride, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Great and marvelous are your works, Adonai Yahweh Elohim. Just and true are your ways, O King of the called out and the set apart. Who shall not fear you, O Yahweh, and honor your name? For you alone, in and of yourself, are set apart. All nations shall come and worship before you, for your judgments are made manifest. Master, we welcome you into our midst this day. For you are with us and in us and for us. And you are infinitely greater than he who is in the world. Your name is lifted above all names and it sets itself apart. For you alone are Yahweh, he who is existence himself, the bearer of breath bringing all into being. And in Yeshua, who is Yahweh made flesh, you save us from all existential threat, atoning for us and delivering us from the power of the adversary and from the power of darkness unto the consummate power, transferring us into the kingdom of the Son of your love, in whom we have redemption through his blood and the forgiveness of every way in which we have missed the mark. For again, Yeshua is the express image of the invisible power, the firstborn over every creature. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of you, Elohim, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. Father, we repent before you, for all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every one to his own way, and you have laid on him the iniquity of us all. We thank you also for your Spirit in us, who helps us in our weaknesses and infirmities. For we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but your Spirit makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. And you, who searches the hearts, knows what is in the mind of your Spirit, because he maketh intercession for we who are called out to you according to your purpose and your will. And we know that all things work together for good and function to them that love you, O consummate power, Elohim, to them who are called according to your purpose. Just and true are your judgments, Yahweh, for you objectively right wrongs, restoring order and harmony, and you have called us to do the same. For tzaddik u'mishpat, justice and judgment, are the foundation of your throne. Your kingdom will come. Your will be done. Your kingdom is in us, and we seek it first, along with your justice, knowing all these other things shall be added unto us as well. We come into complete and total agreement with you concerning your will. May it be established upon the earth, just as you have expressed it in the heavens. All that is relating to our fixed portion of fight and to our daily bread, you have apportioned, customized, and given us today. We thank you. Forgive us for all in which we are owing to you, as we also forgive those who are owing to us. We thank you for enabling us to progress forward by lifting us out of the debts incurred by our transgressions. And you will not lead us into a hand of prolonged intensive testing, except that you may deliver us from the breaker, Hasatan, and from dysfunction. For unto you is the kingdom and the prevailing might and the distinguished adornment, now and into hidden eternity. Amen, in the name of Yeshua. And so it is. So that's how you begin. You begin with the Master's Prayer. And the Master's Prayer is a declaration of his word. It's a declaration of what he has spoken. Speak it back to him. And as you speak it back to him, he looses his messengers to minister unto you who is inheriting salvation, unto me who is inheriting his salvation. He commissions them, he gives them a charge to act upon his word on your behalf. So we've begun. If you feel the need to, pause the video, go back again, pray again. If the Ruach Kedosh, Yahweh's set apart spirit, quickens something within you, if he convicts you of something, if he brings something to your mind, pause the video and deal with that right here, right now. Today is your day for salvation. Today is your day to break free from this thing called depression. And if you're ready to proceed, let us proceed. And as we do so, allow me to state categorically that life is spiritual. Whether you believe it or not, you need to know that all natural phenomenon and every material manifestation is first conceived in the spiritual realm, before you see it manifest in the physical. Just like the way a baby is conceived, nurtured in the womb, and birthed naturally into the realm of the earth. I want you to just consider that for a moment. You also need to know that we as human beings are not, as we so often suppose ourselves to be, free agents. We are always, at all times, everywhere, subject to the influence of spiritual forces operating beyond the limited scope of this dimension of time and space. In fact, the real application of our free will is primarily in the choice of which spiritual force a person will submit themselves to at any given moment of their lives. At any given moment. That's what having free will means. You get to choose whose camp you're aligning with. I'm going to say that again. That's what having free will means. That you get to choose whose camp you're aligning with. Now, based on your choices, you are either walking according to the course of this world, under the sway of the adversary and the power of darkness, or you are abiding in the love and the word of the Most High, He who is existence Himself, walking in His light, led by His Spirit, and living in obedience to His word. Another thing you need to recognize is that each camp has an end goal with you in mind. The goal of the adversary's camp is to steal, kill, and destroy you. The goal of the Creator's camp is that you may have life and have it more abundantly. Also, keep in mind that every human being born into this world comes fully loaded with data and a genetic code. It's in your DNA and in your bloodline. This data has all your passwords, your history, your potential, your inclinations, your hopes and your dreams, your inheritance, your traumas, as well as the manufacturer's original intention in your creation. And every moment of your existence is being updated to the cloud. I'm going to say that again. I think you need to hear it again. So let me rewind selector. Keep in mind that every human being born into this world comes fully loaded with data and a genetic code. It's in your DNA and it's in your bloodline. This data has all your passwords, your history, your potential, your inclinations, your hopes and your dreams, your inheritance, your traumas, as well as the manufacturer's original intention in your creation. And every moment of your existence is being updated to the cloud. That's a parable right there for you. So you just think about it as I sip some water. Now, the Creator's camp has legit access to your records, including the manufacturer's manual with all your specifications. I'm going to say that again. The Creator's camp has legit access to your records, including the manufacturer's manual with all your specifications. And in order to safeguard those records, Yahweh has given us His instructions and sealed us with His Spirit. In the book of Proverbs, it says, "The fear of Yahweh is the beginning of wisdom, and knowledge of the set-apart one is understanding." It also says the fear of Yahweh is the discipline of wisdom, a thing that limits, it sets limits and restricts. And the reason there are those restrictions is because there's a threat outside. That's why we have security fences. That's why we need a hedge of protection, because there's an existential threat outside. The name Hasatan is the adversary, the one who is opposed to, the one who is standing as an enemy against you and against our Father, our Creator. His camp has a whole bunch, millions of ancient, expert spiritual hackers. Ancient, expert spiritual hackers, whose entire mandate is to monitor your moves, trip you up, and lead you astray so that they can get you to hand over your pin through sin. What pin am I talking about? What these spiritual forces are trying to do is to tap into your DNA and into your bloodline. They want to know the manufacturer's intention in creating you. And the reason they want to know that is so that they can know how to steal, kill, and destroy you. They also want to know what is in your bloodline that can trip you up. Where are your weaknesses? What are the weak links in your chain? all the way from Adam right down through to you right now, right here today. They want to know what are your strengths so that they can get you to avoid developing those. They want to know what your potential is so they can also know how to use you to circumvent that potential and use it in the kingdom of darkness to further their agenda. Our enemy is not a fool, and he hasn't been alive for a short time. He's been there from at least the beginning of mankind's existence upon the earth, and we don't know how many ages before then he existed. So do not underestimate the adversary. That being said, do not be afraid of him. We are going to go over this later on in the study, but Yahweh has given us a key. Submit yourselves to Elohim. Submit yourselves to the Almighty, to the consummate power, to the Most High. Then resist the devil, resist the adversary. Simply say no, resist him, and he will flee from you. So it doesn't matter how strong or powerful or whatever illusion or disillusion he's giving you, that's the key. Humble yourself, submit yourself to the Almighty. And when you do so, now the adversary has to deal with him instead of dealing with you. Resist him and he will flee from you. I guarantee this to you. I guarantee it to you. So, maji. Leo nitakunywa maji mob. I'm also giving you time to think. Please, think. Think along. Stay with me. Let's go. Now, when these guys get you to hand over your PIN through sin, their work is to introduce viruses into your system that will corrupt you, body, soul, and spirit, so that you malfunction and ultimately end up completely destroyed. Can I say that again? When this adversary gains access to your passwords, when you sin, you literally give him access to your passwords. What they do then is introduce viruses into your system. They introduce viruses into your system. I'm going to speak in parables so that those who are seeking will find, you know. I want you to think. I want you to engage. The Hebraic mindset is very concrete, so we're going to be very concrete today and always. So their work is to introduce viruses into your system that will corrupt you, body, soul, and spirit, so that you malfunction and ultimately end up completely destroyed. That's how they steal, kill, and destroy you. Now, as I stated earlier, depression first checks into a person as a heavy feeling that weighs you down. Now, let's talk about feelings and emotions for a moment, because these are very, very, very important. They are actually a key, a tool we have been given. And let me tell you what that tool is for. We exist in this dimension, in this plane of the earth, in this dimension of time and space, as body, soul, and spirit. They are interconnected. The body is this outer covering, this outer form that is made in the image and likeness of the Most High. It is. This body is a house. It's our house on earth. It's a temple. So you have your body, your outer shell. This body is made of Adam. This is Adam from Adama, the ground. That's what Adama is, the ground that Adam was made from, his physical body was made from. This physical body has life as long as there's a soul and a spirit living in it. The spirit, the breath, the ruach, that's what the word spirit means. The word ruach means breath, wind, spirit. So this body has life as long as the breath of the living creator, the living almighty power, the consummate power who brings all into being, is within it. When a person dies, that breath leaves and goes back to him. Now, in creating us, what Yahweh did is also he breathed into this body and it became a living soul. A soul. A soul is the entirety of your living personality, your mind, will, and your what? Emotions. The soul is the entirety of your living personality, your mind, will, and emotions. Now, when the body dies and the breath, the ruach, the spirit that is in this body animating it returns to the creator, the soul, which is an eternal being, because it is birthed from Yahweh, it is brought out of eternity and will remain into eternity. That soul now goes wherever a person determined they would go while they were here on earth. So you either aligned with the camp of Yahweh and will end up with him for eternity, or you aligned with the camp of the adversary and will end up with him for eternity. The choice is yours. I'd like you to just pause and consider right now, because we don't know about tomorrow. We don't even know about 5 minutes from now. While I'm sipping this water, pause and consider. What have you willed? If you were to Zima just now, if you were just to go, where would you go? Please ask yourself that question right now. So, body, soul, spirit. Now, your feelings, your emotions, this is what they're supposed to do. This is the work they're actually mandated with. They let you know which spiritual frequency you have tuned yourself into. The emotions are like someone with a radio turning the dial. The emotions are an evidence of the music that comes out. Think of the emotions as that music coming out. Now, the turning of the dial is you tuning into frequencies. That's by the things that you think, the things that you do, your spiritual alignment. So your emotions will tell you into what spirit you have tuned yourself into. Because another aspect of our existence upon this plane is we are body, soul, and spirit. So there's the breath of Yahweh, the spirit, his spirit, that is animating your body and causing your soul to live upon this earth. Now, your soul can come in and out of your body. It can. It can come in and out of your body. I know there are many out there who've experienced astral projection. There are others who've had near-death experiences. Your soul can come in and out of your body. But while your body is living, there's a link, there's a chain. So there's a link that connects the soul. So even if it exits the body, it's still linked to it. It's still tied to it. Another thing about your body is you can host other spirits. You can host the spirit of the Most High Elohim, the spirit of consummate power. The bearer of breath who brings all into being can dwell in you. Now, if the spirit of the Most High is not dwelling in you, another spirit can be dwelling in you and most likely is. These bodies were not meant to be left empty. If they are vacated completely, they die. What are you feeling right here, right now? What is the principal emotion you're experiencing? That emotion, that feeling is telling you what you are tuned into.
So I'm going to give you a practical example from the scripture using the story of Peter, one of Yeshua's disciples. He asked his disciples saying, "Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And they said, "Some say thou art John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." He saith unto them, But whom say ye that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, Thou art the Messiah, the Anointed One, the Son of the Living Elohim. And Yeshua answered and said unto him, Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, son of Jonah, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. I'm going to say that again. Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. Basically, he's saying, this is not a revelation you came by on a carnal plane, you know, just from the information and knowledge you have here. This is something that has been revealed to you by the Spirit of the Most High Elohim, by my Father in heaven. So in that moment of time, Simon, in his alignment with the word and the truth of Elohim concerning who Yeshua is, was directly aligned with the Father and received his revelation. And then Yeshua proceeds to say, And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock, what rock? This state of your being Peter, in alignment with the Most High, to where he can reveal his will directly to you himself. Upon this rock, I will build my church, my ecclesia, my called out ones. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. Then charged he his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Yeshua the Messiah, because it was not yet time for that revelation to be made publicly known. Things had not yet been set in place. He had not yet paid the price that had to be paid. He had not yet overcome death and risen from it. He had not yet disarmed the principalities and the powers. He had not yet cleansed the heavenlies with the blood of his, you know, his blood upon the cross. Now, from that time forth began Yeshua to show unto his disciples, to those who had received the revelation, to those who were already founded upon the rock, who were already in right alignment and in relationship with the Father, how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed and be raised again the third day. So now you guys, and we just pause and think about this, eh? Peter has received this revelation and shared it. And Yeshua has said, Well done, man. You got that straight from heaven, straight from the Father. And what is this revelation? That Yeshua is the Son of the Living Elohim, the Son. You know, the Hebrews, these guys are coming from a Hebraic background. They know the power of the Most High. They have it in their history. They have seen his hand at work, made strong on their behalf time and time again. They have seen him come against the deities of all the other lands and defeat them soundly. Yani, there's no even compare. So this revelation has been received by these guys. You can imagine how elated Peter was and all the other disciples. Then Yeshua comes and starts telling them, by the way, you guys, now that you know this, eh, I must go to Jerusalem to do what? To suffer. Eh? Ati? Come again? Suffer many things of who? The elders and the chief priests and the scribes. But see, you are the Son of the Living Elohim. And then, and be killed. Hey, you guys. And be raised again the third day. Yani, imagine someone you love and who is so dear to you, you become dependent upon them. And they've revealed to you the level of their power. And then they come telling you that they're about to be killed. You guys. Can you imagine the dip in the emotions that happens there? So what does Peter do? Peter took him and began to rebuke him. He actually took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, Be it far from thee, Master. This shall not be unto thee. Hmm? Are you doubting our security? Eh? Kwani, is he the Son of the Living Elohim? You know, this is where he's coming from. But which spirit is he aligned to in that moment?
You see, this is the thing. You're either responding to Yahweh's spirit or responding to the spirit of the adversary and his agents. And the adversary did not want Yeshua to pay the price. He did not want the penalty for sin to be done away with. He did not want prophecy to be fulfilled. He did not want the prisoners to be set free. He did not want his power that had been ceded to him by the sin and disobedience of Adam to be taken away from him by the last Adam, the second Adam, the living Adam, the life-giving spirit Adam, who Yeshua came to be as a son of man. So he's like, hey, you guy, how do I get this thing not to happen before it does? Let me use those close to him. I see if I can influence him, influence Yeshua away from fulfilling the mandate, his mandate here on earth. This is the spirit that now Peter is aligning with in this moment. So he says, be it far from thee, master. This shall not be unto thee. That right there was directly against the will of Elohim. And what does Yeshua tell him? But Yeshua turned and said unto Peter, get thee behind me, Hasatan. Thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of Elohim, but those that be of men. What Yeshua is doing here is not, he's not insulting Peter. He's not even talking to Peter. He's talking to the spirit that is influencing Peter, who does not know any better. Yeshua knows the battle is not against flesh and blood. It's against the principalities and the powers, the prince of the air who is influencing people to disobedience. And he directly addresses that spirit. Just as when Peter received revelation from the Most High, he brought praise to the Father for bringing this revelation to his disciples. So that's a very concrete example of what I'm saying. Your emotions are a direct and very clear indicator of what spiritual frequency you're tuning yourself into. As I stated earlier, depression first checks into a person as a heavy feeling that weighs you down. If you let that feeling of being depressed linger, it becomes a way of thinking and an automized state of mind. And when that state of mind becomes entrenched in you, it opens the door to the foul spirit of depression that sent you that feeling in the first place. Yep, that depressed feeling didn't just come out of nowhere. Mm-mm. No, there are frequencies you're tuning into, and the enemy is constantly trying to get a hold of us. So he's constantly putting out feelers there. Now, depending on what we are doing with our body, soul, and spirit, we then make ourselves susceptible. We are the ones who open doors. We are the ones who give him access. What he does to gain that access is he's very good at deceiving, at creating illusions. He's the master liar. That's his tongue. If you remain in alignment with the Father, if you abide in the Word, and if you allow his spirit to fill you up, Yahweh's spirit will keep you and protect you, because the false spirits of the adversary's camp cannot stay in his presence. They cannot. They cannot stand it. The false spirits cannot bear the light. That darkness cannot bear the light. As soon as the light comes, it dispels darkness. And there is a name that is greater, the name of our Savior Yeshua, unto whom every knee shall bow and every tongue confess that he is master. I'm going to go into more about the identity of our Savior, because you know, you need to know who is on your side. Eh? You need to know who's standing with you. You need to know who's in you. You need to know that power, because Satan, what he does is deceiving. And how he's able to deceive people is, my people perish for lack of knowledge. They have the knowledge. It's not just any kind of knowledge. It's lack of the knowledge, hada'at. What is this specific knowledge he's talking about in that scripture? The knowledge of Elohim, of who he is. Who is this consummate power, and who is the Savior that he has sent? So The Hebrews are very concrete in their understanding of existence. The Hebraic mindset, and I keep coming back to that Hebraic mindset because that is the mindset of the scripture. You have to take the scripture within its context in order to be able to apply it properly. In the Hebraic mindset, a name is a symbolic memorial of an entity's character and its function. So the name Yeshua comes from the name Yahoshua, which is formed of two words, Yah, which is the contracted form of Yahweh, and the word Yasha, which is to save from a threat, to deliver someone from danger. So the name Yeshua literally means he who is existence himself, Yahweh, the bearer of breath who brought all into being, saves us from all existential threat and delivers us from the power of the adversary, transferring us into the kingdom of the Most High Power, the kingdom of the Son of His love, by whom we have redemption through His blood and the forgiveness of sin. That's what the name Yeshua means. Now, Psalm 27 verse 1, Yahweh is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? Yahweh is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? Isaiah chapter 9 verse 2, 6 and 7. The people that walked in darkness have seen a great light. They that dwell in the land of the shadow of death, upon them hath the light shined. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty Power, the Mighty El, the Mighty Power, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. When you look into it, he's literally saying, these people cannot save themselves and they're not able to keep my instructions. I myself must go and fulfill that role of Adam. I must redeem that role. So, and this is why in the New Covenant scriptures, in the letters and the Gospels, the letters of the Apostles and the Gospels, you see them talking about a hidden mystery, a hidden truth of Yeshua. Because it's something, I'm telling you, we cannot fully grasp in this dimension. We cannot, not in our fallen state, that Yahweh himself gave himself a son. He himself became a son of man and son of the living Elohim in order to save and redeem us. You know, that Yahweh, one being existing as Father, Son, and Ruach Kedosh, Father, Son, and Spirit, that's something we cannot fully grasp in its entirety on this plane. But this is what he's saying. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty Power, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and shalom, there shall be no end. Upon the throne of David and upon his kingdom, to order it and to establish it with judgment, setting things in order and harmony, and with justice, righting wrongs from henceforth even forever. The zeal of Yahweh of hosts, Yahweh Tsevaot, will perform this. So now, when Yahweh comes to earth in this form, he makes sure that he clearly defines who he is as a son of man and as a son of the living Elohim. He makes sure to define it in very concrete terms, and that's what I'm going to go into right now. I need you to know who Yeshua is. So John 1 verse 1 to 17, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with Yahweh, and the Word was Yahweh. The same was in the beginning with Yahweh, with He who is existence himself, the bearer of breath who brings all into being. The same was in the beginning with Yahweh. All things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness comprehends it not. That was the true light which lights every man that comes into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of Elohim, of Yahweh, even to them that believe on his name, which were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of Yahweh. And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his kavod, his weight, his honor, the kavod as of the only begotten of the Father, full of favor and truth. John bore witness of him and cried, saying, "This was he of whom I spoke. He that comes after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And of his fullness have all we received, and favor for favor. For the law, the Torah, the instruction was given by Moshe, but favor and truth came by Yeshua, the Anointed One, the Messiah." John sees Yeshua coming unto him and says, "Behold, the Lamb of Yahweh, which taketh away the sin of the world." Why a lamb? A sacrifice had to be made to atone for sin. Blood had to be shed, because the life is in the blood. So where sin has corrupted one bloodline, then a pure blood has to be applied to cover over that sin, to blot it out. So already we are seeing two concrete ways in which Yeshua is being defined. One as the Word. In the Hebrew mindset, words are things. What you speak manifests, it comes into being. The word davar means word and thing. Words are things. Secondly, he's defined as the Lamb of Elohim. Now, John 8 verse 12, "Then spoke Yeshua again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that follows me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life." That's third concrete thing. John 9:5, "As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." Now, we are living in a dispensation when Yeshua has ascended, he's risen into heaven, and he has sent us the Spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, your young men shall see visions. And he has mandated us to be what? The light of the world and the salt of the earth. But while he was in the world, he declared, "As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." And I declare it too. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. Father, shine forth strongly through me. John 12, verse 44 to 50. Yeshua cried and said, "He that believes on me, believes not on me, but on him that sent me. And he that sees me, sees him that sent me. I am come a light into the world, that whosoever believes on me should not abide in darkness. And if any man hear my words and believe not, I judge him not. For I came not to judge the world, but to save the world." Yeshua is saying in his first coming here, he came not to judge, but to save. When he comes again, he's coming to judge. Keep that in mind. "He that rejects me and receives not my words has one that judges him. The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day. For I have not spoken of myself, but the Father which sent me, he gave me a commandment, what I should say and what I should speak. And I know that his commandment is life everlasting. Whatsoever I speak, therefore, even as the Father said unto me, so I speak." His commandment is life everlasting. So he's come as the light of the world so that we do not walk in darkness. Remember, we're here today overcoming depression. Depression will ensure that you walk in darkness. So, turn to the light. John 6, verse 32 to 35. "Then Yeshua said unto them, Verily, verily, truly, I say unto you, Moshe gave you not that bread from heaven, but my Father giveth you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of Elohim, the bread of consummate power, the bread of the Almighty One, is He who comes down from heaven and gives life unto the world. Then said they unto him, Rabbi, evermore give us this bread. And Yeshua said unto them, I am the bread of life. Allow me to just pause and give you some context there. When this, in this section of the scripture, the people he's speaking to are referring back to the time of the deliverance from the captivity in Mitzrayim, in Egypt, while the people were transcending or journeying through the wilderness, when for 40 years, day and every single day, Yahweh fed the people with manna from heaven. The word there is, the Hebrew word is actually man, which means what? It was something they had, they didn't know how to define it. So they called it what? What is this? What? Man. Manna. See? Manna. What? So, and Yeshua said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, and he that believes on me shall never thirst. So that's a fourth aspect Yeshua is revealing himself concretely in. John 10 verse 7 to 16. Then Yeshua said unto them again, verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. All that ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. The thief cometh not but for to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. So, the door of the sheep. John 10 verse 11 to 16. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. But he that is an hireling and not the shepherd, whose own sheep are not, sees the wolf coming and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf catches them and scatters the sheep. The hireling flees because he is a hireling and cares not for the sheep. I am the good shepherd and know my sheep and am known of mine. As the Father knows me, even so know I the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. And other sheep I have, which are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold, one shepherd. So he is the good shepherd. John 11 verse 25 to 26. Yeshua said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Believe you this? Yeshua is the resurrection and the life. That's number 7. John 14 verse 1 to 7. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in Yahweh, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions, many dwellings. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, you know. Where I go, you know. And the way, you know. Thomas said unto him, Rabbi, teacher, we know not. Actually, the word rabbi comes from, you know, the word for a great one. We know not whither you go. And how can we know the way? Yeshua said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes unto the Father but by me. If ye had known me, ye should have known my Father also. And from henceforth, ye know him and have seen him. So he is the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come unto the Father but by him, because he is the only one qualified to and the only one who has actually paid the price that was required in order to atone for sin. And without the atonement for sin, no man can appear before the Father. So there are not many ways. There's only one. The way, the truth, and the life is Yeshua. He's the only one who could and who did pay the price. He's the only one who qualified as the perfect Lamb of Elohim. John 15, verse 1 to 17. I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, he taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, he purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now you are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can you, except you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. He that abides in me and I in him, the same brings forth much fruit. For without me, ye can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If ye abide in me and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father honored, that ye bear much fruit, so shall ye be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. If ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy may remain in you, and that your joy might be full. This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends, if ye do whatsoever I command you. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knows not what his master does, but I have called you friends. For all things that I have heard of my Father, I have made known unto you. You have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that you should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it to you. These things I command you, that you love one another. Wow. Thank you, Father, for making us your friends, for calling us forth, for loving us with an everlasting love. We love you because you first loved us. Yeshua is the true vine. So let's review. Who is Yeshua? Who is our Savior? What is his identity as he himself defined it? Yeshua is the word of the living power made flesh. He is the pure sacrificial lamb of the Most High Elohim. He is the light of the world. He is the bread of life. Yeshua is the door of the sheep by which we come into his fold. He is the good shepherd laying his life down for his sheep. He is the resurrection and the life. He is the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come to the Father except through him. He is the true vine, and we are his branches. Yeshua is the Son of the living power and the Son of Man. He came as a man. He knows what it is to be a human being. He knows what it is to go through depression. There is nothing that he does not know what it is to go through, because he came and lived this life. So now we're going to go into how depression attacks. But before we do that, you can imagine, please. Well, you're thinking about who Yeshua is. And then now I'll ask you, who is Yeshua to you? Now, this is how depression attacks. Hey. Depression targets the very core of a human being. the very core. It will usually strike at something attached to the six basic primal needs that every person has. Yeah, six basic primal needs. Number one, the pang of hunger. You know, the need to feed daily is at the heart of our autonomy. Depression attacks our sense of autonomy by making us feel worthless. The second one, the second primal need or primal urge, is the sexual drive. The urge to merge and to reproduce is at the heart of a human's legacy. Depression attacks that legacy by seeking any means by which it can corrupt a man's seed. Mm-hmm. The third primal urge is the desire to protect loved ones. Now, to love and be loved is at the heart of community. Depression attacks your experience of community by causing you to isolate yourself. The fourth primal urge is the instinct to survive and thrive. To overcome the odds is at the heart of your resilience. Depression attacks your resilience by draining your energy. It literally sucks the life out of you. The fifth one is the fear of death. To live out your days long and well is at the heart of your eternal reality. Basically, how you live this life will determine your eternal reality. Depression attacks your eternal reality by making you feel that life is not worth living, so you live it carelessly. The final primal urge is the need to connect and commune with a higher power. To be joined to the source is at the heart of purpose. Depression targets your sense of purpose by seeking to sever you from your source. Higher. Yeah, Sela, you might need to pause and just rewind selector, go back and hear that again. But don't worry, there's a PDF available in the description box below. Feel free to access that at any time. So these are the battle strategies to fight against depression. Number one, when depression masquerades as a feeling, guard your heart with all diligence. Proverbs 4 verse 18 to 27. But the path of the just, thus objectively righting wrongs, is as the shining light that shines more and more unto the perfect day. The way of the wicked is as darkness. They know not at what they stumble. My son, attend to my words. My daughter, attend to my words. Incline thine ear unto my sayings. Let them not depart from thine eyes. Keep them in the midst of your heart. For they are life unto those that find them and health to all their flesh. Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Put away from you a crooked mouth and perverse lips that are turned away from what is right. Put those far from thee. Let thine eyes look right on, and let your eyelids look straight before you. Ponder the path of your feet, and let all your ways be established. Turn not to the right hand, nor to the left. Remove your foot from dysfunction. The second thing you need to do is to shift your mental focus from what is happening on this plane and pivot it onto the person of existence himself. Psalms 4, to the chief musician on Neginoth, a psalm of David. Hear me when I call, O Elohim, O consummate power of my justice. You have enlarged me when I was in distress. Have mercy upon me, Haneni Yahweh. Enable me and hear my prayer. O ye sons of men, how long will you turn my honor into shame? How long will you love vanity and seek after leasing? Selah, that means pause and weigh that thought. But know that Yahweh has set apart him that is reverent for himself. Yahweh will hear when I call unto him. Stand in awe and sin not. Commune with your own heart upon your bed and be still. Selah. Pause and weigh that thought. Offer the sacrifices of justice, objectively right wrongs, and put your trust in Yahweh. There be many that say, who will show us any good? Yahweh, lift thou up the light of your countenance upon us. You have put gladness in my heart, more than in the time that their corn and their wine increased. I will both lay me down in peace, in shalom, and sleep. For you, Yahweh, only makest me dwell in safety. John chapter 15, verse 9 to 13. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. If ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you, and that your joy might be full. This is my commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. Ye are my friends if ye do whatsoever I command you. The third thing you need to do when depression masquerades as a feeling is elevate your emotions by engaging in an uplifting action that will serve one of your primal, practical human needs, or that of another. Proverbs 15, verse 13 and 15. A merry heart maketh a cheerful countenance, but by sorrow of the heart the spirit is broken. All the days of the afflicted are dysfunctional, but he that is of a merry heart has a continual feast. Proverbs 17, verse 22. A merry heart does good like medicine, but a broken spirit dries the bones. Nehemiah 8, verse 8 to 12. So they read in the book, in the law of the consummate power, distinctly, and gave the sense, and caused them to understand the reading. Let me just pause to give you some context there. In the history of the nation of Israel, there was a covenant that was made between them and the Most High when they were in the wilderness, transitioning from slavery in the land of Mitzrayim and going into the promised land as led by Moshe, the prophet. Now, when Yahweh gave them the 10 words upon the Mount Sinai, a covenant was ratified between them, what we know as the first covenant, and in modern day English, Old Testament, but it's the first covenant. Now, there were blessings that would accompany walking in obedience to that covenant and curses that would accompany walking in disobedience to that covenant. So the nation of Israel throughout their history, the scripture records what would happen when they would obey and what would happen when they would disobey. Now, the book of Nehemiah was written at a time when the nation of Israel had been sent into exile because of their disobedience to the covenant. It was one of the curses that would come upon them for disobeying that covenant. And Nehemiah used to be a governor in the foreign land, but he was sent back to his, he requested to be sent back to his people, back to his land, to see how to address the needs of the people there, and to come and build the wall of Jerusalem, the principal city, which had been broken down. So he successfully did that, and Nehemiah was working in conjunction with people like Ezra. So the book of Ezra and the book of Nehemiah were written at around the same time. Now, this is the context for this scripture. So, Nehemiah 8, verse 8 to 12. So they read in the book, in the law, in the instruction of consummate power distinctly, and gave the sense, and caused them to understand the reading. And Nehemiah, which is the governor, and Ezra the priest, the scribe, and the Levites that taught the people, said unto all the people, this day is set apart unto Yahweh, your power, your consummate power. Mourn not, nor weep. For all the people wept when they heard the words of the instruction of the Torah. Then he said unto them, go your way, eat the fat and drink the sweet, and send portions unto them for whom nothing is prepared. For this day is set apart unto our master. Neither be ye sorry, for the joy of Yahweh is your strength. So the Levite stilled all the people, saying, "Hold your peace, for the day is set apart, neither be ye grieved." And all the people went their way to eat and to drink and to send portions and to make great mirth, because they had understood the words that were declared unto them. A practical way in which I have employed this, and I can witness, boy, do I bear witness that this works. Man, depression often comes upon us as human beings when we, as a feeling, when we are tired or fatigued, when we are ill in body, you know, and feeling unwell, and also when we are hungry. So when you start feeling depressed, check, am I hungry? Am I tired? Am I feeling unwell? Address those primal needs. One of the things I do concretely is, I have a playlist on this channel, A Daily Dose of Mr. Fantastic. This guy is a brilliant comedian from the nation of Nigeria, who has a very incisive take on social media and current affairs on the continent of Africa and just in the world in general. So during my downtime, I will sit down with something delicious to eat or to drink and just enjoy Mr. Fantastic's videos. Now, I'm not endorsing the entirety of his channel. I haven't gone through everything he's put on there. But the ones that I have curated on my playlist are ones at least I can stand by according to the scripture. So feel free to check that playlist out, because, dude, it helps me. Man, that guy makes me laugh. Ni dawa, it is medicine, you guys. When you see me there, I'm in therapy. Thank you, Mr. Fantastic. Bless you, brother. I lift you up in prayer. So, now, when depression has already developed into a state of mind, this is what you do. Number one, grab a hold of your tongue and train it to speak life. Proverbs 18 verse 4 and 20 to 21. The words of a man's mouth are as deep waters, and the wellspring of wisdom as a flowing brook. A man's belly shall be satisfied with the fruit of his mouth, and with the increase of his lips shall he be filled. Death and life are in the power, are in the hand of the tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. John 6 verse 63. It is the spirit that quickeneth, the flesh profiteth nothing. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. The second thing you need to do is actively meditate on the living word in order to transform and renew your mind. Psalms 1. Blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the lawbreakers or the wicked, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the Torah, the instruction of Yahweh, and in his Torah does he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he does shall prosper. The wicked, the lawbreakers, are not so, but are like the chaff which the wind drives away. Therefore the wicked shall not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the just. For Yahweh knows the way of the just, but the way of the wicked shall perish. Joshua 1 verse 8 and 9. This book of the Torah, of the instruction, shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then you shall make your way prosperous, and then you shalt have good success. Have not I commanded thee? Be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid, neither be dismayed. For Yahweh thy power is with thee wherever you go. The third thing you need to do is to change your point of view on trials and tribulations. Observe them from the Father's perspective, in light of his word and his divine plan for you. Change your POV. Psalms 42, to the chief musician, Maskil, for the sons of Korah. As the heart pants after the water brooks. So pants my soul after thee, O consummate power, Elohim. My soul thirsts for Elohim, for the living consummate power. When shall I come and appear before you, Elohim? My tears have been my meat day and night, while they continually say unto me, where is thy power? Where is thy Elohim? When I remember these things, I pour out my soul in me. For I had gone with the multitude. I went with them to the house of consummate power, with the voice of joy and praise, with a multitude that kept that set apart day. Why art thou cast down, O my soul, and why are you disquieted in me? You hope in consummate power, for I shall yet praise him for the help of his countenance. O my consummate power, O my Elohim, my soul is cast down within me. Therefore will I remember thee from the land of Jordan and of the Harmonites, from the hill Mizar. Deep calls unto deep at the noise of thy water spouts. All thy waves and thy billows are gone over me. Yet Yahweh will command his chesed, his loving kindness in the daytime, and in the night his song shall be with me, and my prayer unto the consummate power of my life. I will say unto you, Elohim, my rock, why hast thou forgotten me? Why go I mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? As with a sword in my bones, mine enemies reproach me, while they say daily unto me, where is thy consummate power? Why are you cast down, O my soul, and why are you disquieted within me? Hope thou in the consummate power, in Elohim, for I shall yet praise him, who is the health of my countenance and my consummate power. James 1 verse 2 to 8. My brethren, count it all joy when ye fall into diverse trials, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. But let patience have her perfect work, that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask of Elohim, that giveth to all men liberally and upbraideth not, and it shall be given him. But let him ask in faith, in a steady steadfastness, nothing wavering. For he that wavereth is like the wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. For let not that man think that he shall receive anything of the master. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. Let the brother of low degree rejoice in that he is exalted. When the spirit of depression has gained a stronghold in you and bound your spirit, when now the spirit has actually checked in and is oppressing you, the first thing you need to do is confess and repent of your own iniquity and that of your bloodline. Repent for the sins of your fathers and your mothers. Psalms 43. Judge me, O Elohim, and plead my cause against a wicked nation. O deliver me from the deceitful and unjust man. For thou art the consummate power of my strength. Why do you cast me off? Why go I mourning because of the oppression of the enemy? O send out your light and your truth. Let them lead me. Let them bring me unto thy set-apart hill and to thy tabernacles. Then will I go unto the altar of Yahweh, the consummate power, unto Elohim, my exceeding joy. Yea, upon the harp will I praise thee, O consummate power, my consummate power. Why are you cast down, O my soul, and why are you disquieted within me? Hope in Elohim, for I shall yet praise him, who is the health of my countenance and my consummate power. James 4, verse 7 to 10. Submit yourselves, therefore, to consummate power, to Elohim. Resist the devil. Say no to him, and he will flee from you. The devil is an accuser. That's what that name means, accuser, diablos. Draw nigh to consummate power, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Be afflicted and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to heaviness. Humble yourselves in the sight of Yahweh, and he shall lift you up. The second thing you need to do is to put on the full armor of consummate power so that you can fight against that spirit. Ephesians 6, verse 10 to 20. Finally, my brethren, be strong in Yahweh and in the consummate power of his might. Put on the whole armor of Elohim, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil, of the accuser. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of consummate power, that ye may be able to withstand in the day of dysfunction, in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, put on the belt of truth, and having on the breastplate of justice, and your feet shod with the preparation of the good news of shalom, of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, of steady steadfastness, wherewith ye shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of consummate power, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all the called out ones, and for me, that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the hidden truth, the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. The third thing you need to do when the spirit of depression has come in and is oppressing you, recognize who you are and whose you are. Ephesians 1 verse 2 to 23. Hanan be to you, divine enabling be to you, grace and peace, shalom, from consummate power our Father, and from the Master Yeshua, HaMashiach, the Messiah, the Anointed One. Blessed be the consummate power and Father of our Master Yeshua, the Messiah, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in the Anointed One, according as he has chosen us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be set apart and without blame before him in love, having predestinated us into the adoption of children by Yeshua the Messiah to himself, according to the functional pleasure of his will, to the praise of the honor of his divine enabling, his grace, wherein he has made us accepted in the beloved, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins, according to the riches of his grace, his enabling, wherein he has abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery, the hidden truth of his will, according to his functional pleasure, which he has purposed in himself, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times, he might gather together in one all things in the Messiah, both which are in heaven and which are on earth, even in him, in whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who works all things after the counsel of his own will, that we should be to the praise of his honor, who first trusted in Messiah, in whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the good news of your salvation, in whom also after you believed, you were sealed with that set apart spirit of promise, which is the earnest of our inheritance, until the redemption of the purchased possession, unto the praise of his honor. Wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Master Yeshua and your love unto all the called out ones, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the consummate power of our Master Yeshua the Messiah, the Father of honor, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him, the eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and what the riches of the kavod, the glory, the weight of his inheritance in the called out ones. And what is the exceeding greatness of his power toward us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in the Anointed One when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world but also in that which is to come, and has put all things under his feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the Ecclesia, the called out ones, which is his body, the fullness of him that fills all in all. Ephesians 2 verse 1 to 10. And you has he quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins, wherein in times past ye walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that now works in the children of disobedience, among whom also we all had our conversation in times past, in the lusts of our flesh, fulfilling the desires of the flesh and of the mind, and were by nature the children of wrath, even as others. But consummate power, who is rich in chesed, in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, has quickened us together with Messiah. By grace, his bestowed traits and his divine enabling, ye are saved. And he has raised us up together and made us sit together in heavenly places in Messiah Yeshua, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us through Messiah Yeshua. For by grace are ye saved through faith, through steadfastness, and that not of yourselves. For by his enabling are ye saved through steadfastness, through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of consummate power, not of works, lest any man should boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Messiah Yeshua unto functional works, which consummate power has before ordained that we should walk in them. So my beloved, speak these words over yourself. Pray these words up to the Father. Speak them into your situation. That's how you wield the sword. And take those practical steps, and I guarantee you that you will overcome depression. And I'm really, really, really looking forward to getting your feedback. I really want to hear your stories in the comments down below. Let me know if you need me to join you in prayer concerning any matter, because I'm interceding for you. You are my family. This YouTube channel is a family, a community of deep to dreamers, you know? So in closing this video, I would like to extend an invitation to you. Will you walk with me? I need you to. I need your feedback. I need your prayers. I need your support. If my content is of value to you, please consider walking with me concretely and commit to it. Keep me accountable. Subscribe, like, comment, share. If you'd also like to support my work through material means, donations are very much welcome and deeply appreciated. You can send your support through MPESA or buy me a coffee. The links and the details are in the description box below. And once again, I just want to thank you even for the thought of it. Finally, I would just like to also express my deep appreciation and gratitude for every single individual who has ever lent me any form of support over the years, be it moral or material, in cash or in kind. You've gotten me through. I bless you and I thank you. Stay tuned for the backstory, episode number 3. Navigating grief. Shalom, beloved. Yeah.